Howdy, Aaron Boster here with the Ohio Health MS Center, planning to spend a few minutes to talk about fatigue in multiple sclerosis. MS fatigue is one of the most common of all MS symptoms. It's also an invisible symptom, which is extremely frustrating because people can't see how exhausted you feel. I always want to make sure that patients and family members know that fatigue is really serious, and it's one of the leading causes that people end up leaving the workforce because they're so profoundly tired. There's many different kinds of fatigue that people with MS experience. Most commonly, we refer to pathologic fatigue. This is the phenomenon where you have a little bit of energy when you start your day, but you very quickly use it up and you're exhausted before the day's almost halfway over, in some cases. Motor fatigue, or heat-sensitive fatigue, is when your body sort of peters out on you after it heats up, whether that be on an extended walk or because it's too hot outside. Cognitive fatigue involves thinking and memory, and it might involve the ability where you can start to read and comprehend, but then after a while, it becomes increasingly difficult. Cognitive fatigue is very, very frustrating and another one of these leading causes of loss of work. It also bears mentioning that many, many other conditions can cause fatigue, and sometimes nature's too generous, and someone with MS can also have other causes of fatigue that have to be considered. When you try to understand fatigue, there's a lot of different theories, and I'm going to share with you one that makes the most sense to me. And I want us to think about fatigue as depleting our neurological reserves, our functional reserves. When I talk about neurological or functional reserve, I'm talking about our nervous system's ability to withstand an insult. Now, I don't mean you're ugly. I mean an insult like you stayed up too late, or you're sleep deprived, or you have an infection, or you're under significant psychosocial stressors. I'll make the point with a personal example. When I was 18, I could skip a night of sleep. Sometimes on Friday after school, I'd work my part-time job, I'd go out with my friends and stay out all night, and the next day I would get up and work my part-time job, and I just wouldn't sleep on Friday. Now, I joke, in my 40s, even saying that out loud makes me exhausted, because my functional reserve isn't what it used to be. As I age, it gets smaller. In the setting of MS, our functional reserves are even smaller. And you might imagine that because there are areas of the brain that aren't working properly, the brain has had to rewire itself. And so when you want to do a task that under normal circumstances would use a little bit of your brain, you might need to recruit lots and lots of surface area, lots of brain just to get the job done. And that can physically make us tired. Now, I like to talk about this concept of spoon theory because I think it explains pathologic fatigue rather well. So imagine that when you start your day, you wake up and you have a certain number of spoons. And these are all the quotients of energy that you're going to have for the entire day. Now, everything you do requires a spoon. So maybe taking a shower is a spoon. And driving into work involves a spoon. And then maybe when you're at work, it uses five spoons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, I want you to imagine that in the setting of MS, as your neurological reserves deplete, you don't have as many spoons when you wake up. Maybe you actually wake up and you only have 4 spoons worth of energy. So waking up and getting dressed and showering, that's 1 spoon. Getting to work, that's 1 spoon. Work costs 5 spoons and you don't have any. And the spoon theory helps you understand how you can quickly deplete energy resources in the setting of MS and other chronic conditions with fatigue. Now, I'd like to share with you 10 tips to help combat fatigue. I'm not giving medical advice. I want to be very specific that I'm educating. And if there's a tip on here that sounds like it might help you out, I want you to talk to your medical provider, your MS provider, about it. The first tip is to take an MS disease-modifying therapy. Whenever you look at the clinical trials and they look at patient-reported outcome measures and they study things like fatigue, almost always, patients on therapy report less fatigue than those that aren't taking one. And so this is a key element. Again, remember that we think fatigue, the underpinnings, is that the brain's having to work too hard. If you have unchecked inflammation because you're undertreated or not treated, that's gonna cause even more work on the brain and you're gonna be more fatigued. So get treated. The second tip is to improve sleep hygiene. Many patients may stay up all night playing on the internet, going to bed at 5, 6 in the morning and then sleeping halfway through the day, or they may take large chunks of naps in the middle of the day. They may be drinking caffeinated beverages or alcoholic beverages right before bed. In other words, there may be many things about the quality and the way they sleep, the behaviors of sleep, which could be improved upon. There's another video here on YouTube that specifically talks about sleep hygiene. So if you have questions, check that out. It's also important to recognize that sometimes nature's too generous, and you may have pathologic fatigue from MS and have a sleep disorder. And so exploring obstructive sleep apnea, finding out if you're a snorer or wake up with headaches, if your bed partner tells you that partway through the snoring you stop breathing, these need to be explored. Restless leg syndrome is a really big one. Spasms and cramps from spasticity or burning ouchy pain from neuropathic pain must be addressed. Also, nocturia, which means I have to get up multiple times a night to go to the bathroom, is a really bad one in MS. And so you want to talk to your provider about making sure that you manage all of these perfectly so that you sleep better and that you get restorative sleep and you're less tired. Depression is rampant in MS. It's over double the general population. People with MS will experience depression. And so depression colors everything ugly, and it's a major contributor to fatigue. If there's any inkling that there might be depression, I strongly, strongly recommend trying to improve it so that you can improve fatigue. Very important. Now, increasingly, there's research teaching us that other factors, other health problems can negatively impact MS, and they can certainly contribute to fatigue. And so if nature has been too generous and you have MS and diabetes or MS and high blood pressure, we have to address it. Morbid obesity contributes to fatigue, as does low thyroid function. You may have certain vitamin deficiencies that can be explored with blood tests with your provider, and if they're low, you may find supplementing them helps. And so we also have to look at drug and alcohol recreational use and how these might play a factor into making us tired. So we can't ignore the rest of you and focus only on MS in order to beat fatigue. Another area that can't be overlooked enough is that of so-called polypharmacy. Doctors with the best of intentions will prescribe a medicine for a patient, but sometimes they forget to pull it away. And so looking at your medication list and streamlining it, talking to your provider about, do I need this one? Maybe I can do half of that one. And trying to decrease the frequency or the number of pills can help with giving you back energy in MS and improving fatigue. A couple tips. Sometimes when a patient is really tired, we'll screen them for urinary tract infection. And even though they don't have any burning when they urinate, we find out they're infected. And that's depleting their functional reserves, their neurological reserves, and it's making them tired. Similarly, it's been our observation that very often when a patient has a clinical MS attack, they're also exhausted. And so I simply suggest that when you're really fatigued, we just keep that in mind. A couple more tips. We've talked a little earlier about being overheated. I have videos on YouTube that discuss heat sensitivity and motor fatigue in MS. But you may find that being in the air conditioning, chugging ice water, wearing a cooling vest, planning when you go outside so it's not so hot, all of these things can really help heat sensitive fatigue and improve the quality of your day. Lifestyle is very, very important. You might need to ask yourself, does my diet contribute to my fatigue? Am I eating lots of sugar and things that make me go on this roller coaster and it actually makes me more tired? Do I have a sedentary lifestyle and maybe I'm deconditioned both because of my MS and because of other lifestyle things? MS patients, unfortunately, may find themselves socially isolated. And when you're socially isolated, you're not out moving around and doing things. Maybe at the present time, the patient doesn't have an exercise program. All of these things need to be carefully looked at and improved upon. And lifestyle changes can have a major, major impact. Exercising is arguably one of the very best things that we could do in order to improve fatigue in MS. And lastly, it's worthwhile having a discussion with your provider about options for medicines and supplements that might improve fatigue. I'm not telling you to take these. I'm saying that sometimes fatigue's so bad that you have to talk to your MS provider about supplementing your vitamins or taking levocarnitine or even prescription stimulant medicines or modafinil. Once again, my name's Aaron Boster. Thank you for tuning in. I'm talking with the Ohio Health MS Center. A few words about beating fatigue in MS. Thank you. Have a great weekend.